Bendixsen, and on this episode of Move, we're going to hit Top Gear as we look at the future of the car. So buckle up and let's ride. A quiet revolution is taking place on our roads. Cars are getting smart, really, really smart. Arguably smarter than some world leaders. Driverless cars are now a reality. Test versions of Google's Waymo are already driving around cities. Its wheels self-steering like some sort of ghostly chauffeur. Turn left, Spooky James. Now, autonomous vehicles have a long history dating back to 1968, as seen in the documentary Herbie the Love Bug. But it could be less than a decade before our cars could be saying to us, "Hey mate, I've got this." So kick back and check your smartphone and we'll get you there before your smartwatch has ordered you a smart latte. Do we need cars being smart? The last thing you'd want is a car telling you what to do, right? Like, you know, a reversing camera or a heads-up display or a fuel gauge. But what we've already seen is that driverless cars aren't a cure-all for road safety. A series of accidents earlier this year have suggested that the all-conquering robots aren't perfect. And there remain some big questions. For instance, will those cars bring an end to road rage or make it worse? If you cut off an autonomous vehicle, might it go all Decepticon on you? And what happens when smart cars meet dumb cars? Do these educated cars, these electricity-sipping sort of elite cars, look down their bonnets at old-fashioned Ford Mustangs and tell them they've just got to stop it with their petrol guzzling and take charge of their own journey? And what's the future for Top Gear? Because I heard robot Jeremy Clarkson is kind of annoying. Well, there's no doubt that we're in a car-obsessed nation. Doing doughies in the car park is a traditional Aussie rite of passage. However, like most of the world, we're paying the price for our car-obsessed ways. But will we be comfortable with the alternative? We asked the person on the street what they think about this revolution on the road.
Giving up the car, it might make a little bit of difference to the planet, but not an awful lot, quite frankly.
Give up my car to save money, yeah.
I think money.
Planet's good too, I like it.
I'm in a wonderful relationship, and we do all we can to make our environment better anyway.
Our relationship?
Time, I would say. If you have time, your relationships is going to be good as well.
So to chat about this new car culture shift, what our cars will look like and who'll be behind the wheel, if there even is a wheel, we've got a couple of experts who are driving the industry forward. So please welcome the Executive Director of ADVI, the Australia and New Zealand Driverless Vehicle Initiative, Rita Excell. And also welcome the organiser of the 72-hour self-driving car challenge and CEO of Teleporter, Ben Sand. So trials and experiments for autonomous vehicles have been going on for quite a while, and I think we've maybe had over 20 trials in Australia with many more around the world. What do we think needs to happen for them to actually roll out in our roads so that we can be using them?
I think there's probably a few things that need to happen. I would say that the cars will probably be about 5 years behind the trucks. So maybe look at what they're doing first, taking over things like the highways. And once they've got that under control, we can start to get out to more challenging scenarios like suburban streets.
So I'm trying to imagine how this shift would take place. Does it mean that suddenly all of our cars would be replaced with a fleet of autonomous vehicles?
I think it's unlikely that there would be a sort of a hard cutover. Maybe in some exceptionally dense areas, they'd create rules that you'd only be allowed to use autonomous vehicles there just because it's very challenging. But most of the time, they're going to be cohabiting with other sorts of vehicles, I think.
I think Australians really love to drive. I mean, I have a confession. I can't actually drive a manual car, but my partner refuses not to have one. You know, because he just loves driving and that sense of being in control. What does it take for us as a nation to give up that control and the idea of being behind the wheel?
Well, I think that might be a bit of a sort of maybe false dichotomy. I don't think just because a car can drive by itself doesn't mean it always will. If you've got cruise control that doesn't have to stay on all of the time. So I really enjoy driving when I'm stressed out. I like to go for a drive, but there's also times when I'm quite stressed out because I am driving, and it's just a very challenging thing to be doing because of everything else that's going on. So I think it's sort of more that we're going to have the choice. You know, maybe when roads are exceptionally congested, there might be some, you know, benefit or reduced toll. If you're willing to have the self-driver take over, you'll be able to connect with other cars, so you'll take up less space. Maybe you pay for the privilege to be in control at that point in time, but the rest of the time you can sort of do what you want.
Nice. And so, Rita, you've been at the forefront of this world for quite a while. You've even got a summit dedicated to this new car culture. What makes enthusiasts passionate about the potential of autonomous vehicles?
Well, I think essentially we have 128 partners, organisations that really want to see this technology come to Australia and New Zealand, but come to Australia and New Zealand in a coordinated way. And I think it's really important to bring the community along with us. We need to understand what their concerns are, but also we need to talk to them about the benefits of the technology. And essentially, when you talk about liking to drive and enjoying driving, we're really talking to people with a disability who don't have access to driving their own personal vehicles. So we have to really understand that this is not technology for technology's sake. It's going to have a benefit to society if we implement it correctly. If we let it happen organically, we'll just get a consumer-driven commercial outcome. What we need to have is a coordinated approach so we get real benefits to society from the technology.
And Ben, you've seen firsthand the work that goes into building a self-driving car. Tell us about the different types of AV and, I suppose, the different players that are involved in that kind of design.
Yeah, well, there's certainly a lot of different companies that go into it. I think the good news in Australia is that we've actually got a perhaps underutilized pool of talent that's actually very relevant to building self-driving cars. We've got a lot of mechanical engineers. We've got a lot of very experienced, in fact, some of the best in the world people at machine vision. So these are the people who take an image and tell you what's in it. It's pretty obvious what to do after that point. You don't want to run over things that shouldn't be run over, and you want to stay between the lines. But knowing where the lines are and whether something's a real person or just a cardboard cutout is the hard part. And that's what we're actually exceptionally good at in this country. So we've got a lot of the really core skills. There's certainly a lot of other large players, like Nvidia's done exceptionally well on this. They've gone from 7 billion market cap up to 120 billion over the last 4 years because they supply the sort of the primary brain for self-driving cars, if you like. A lot of great sensor manufacturers. Baraja locally is doing exceptionally well. The laser scanners that help the cars see. So I think there's probably more types of technology that need to come together than almost any other thing that goes into this. But I think as people in Australia, we should be really excited about how we can contribute. And part of what we did with the 72-hour challenge was try to show people who came from a mechanical engineering or automotive background that self-driving cars weren't for someone else or another place. They're something that we can actually get involved in. We have pretty much all the skills. And people from overseas, when they came to see what we're doing, were so amazed. They said, you know, we work for a giant self-driving car company and they won't let us touch a prototype that hasn't been at least 2 years in development, and you're knocking them out in 3 days. And I think that a lot of people think it's a lot harder than it really is. It's sort of just, you know, better lane keeping assistance, better cruise control. It's just sort of, you know, you just keep adding little bits on. It's not some giant new thing that replaces everything. It's just a little bit better until it's all the way there.
And do you see this creating different kinds of jobs in the automotive industry as well? And what kind of jobs do you think that looks like?
Well, I think today marks 5 years since the announcement that the auto manufacturing industry was pulling out of Australia. And instead of the gloom and doom, a lot of the smart expertise has resided and stayed in Australia and is working towards developing these new technologies. So I think we've shouldered that storm, and there's exciting opportunities. And a lot of the companies that are part of ADVI, essentially they were working overseas and developing their technology in Australia to sell overseas, and now they've got great opportunities in Australia to do that at home, to demonstrate their capabilities. I think that's a great thing that's happened over the last period of, the last 3 years.
Well, there's certainly a lot more parts that go into a self-driving car, so someone's got to make those parts, someone's got to design them, someone's got to figure out how they fit together. And I think that we're exceptionally well positioned to be doing that. There certainly will be different jobs, so people will need to be willing to engage with that. But I do think they use far more of the current skills than people expect. What we found was that a lot of the people who work on the computer side of things just totally freak out when you pass them an angle grinder and say, just go and put this thing in and weld it on. And so it's actually sort of, from a mechanical engineer's perspective, relatively basic stuff that can drive this stuff forward. So I think if they're willing to kind of, get engaged, it can really go somewhere.
Well, one of the biggest conversations around autonomous vehicles is safety. Do you think driverless cars are absolutely more safer than humans driving?
Well, we're wasting our time if they're not. You know, really, that's ultimately we're wasting our time, because if we had a perfect system and we're introducing something that's less perfect, then we're wasting our time. So yes, lots of people can make lots of money, there's lots of investment, but fundamentally the reason why we're doing automation is about making people safer, making the transport system operate better and more safely. So how much safer? I think that's a debate that we're having as engineers and practitioners. How much safer do they have to be before we allow them on the system? So that's an interesting thing, and maybe the community's best place to answer that question.
Now, you mentioned data. They are obviously collecting a lot of data. Naturally, people would then have concerns about privacy. Is that something that can be resolved?
Oh, look, I think people have different concerns about privacy. Essentially, somebody my age group has got a very different perception to somebody who's a lot younger. And sharing your information to get some benefit, I think most people are up for that. So let's see what sort of information we need to share and what benefit we get from it. And insurers are already doing that now with, you know, you opt in and you can get insurance for how far you travel, what sort of a driver you are. So people are ready and willing to share that information if there's a benefit for them. Obviously, for security and safety purposes, some data has to be shared, and we rely on regulators and the police to make sure that data is used for those purposes to keep us safe. So I think the data sharing one is one that we need to work through, but there's opportunities there to share data for benefits.
Yeah, I guess from a safety perspective as well, it would probably make me feel safer to know that some data was being shared, particularly in a group ride sharing situation of an autonomous vehicle. You don't have the extra person there. So from a safety perspective, I guess it's quite important. What does AV mean for people that don't drive?
Well, as I said, we do a public perception survey. It's the most rigorous scientific survey undertaking in Australia and New Zealand. And the biggest turnout as positive feedback is people who are older and people with a disability. In fact, you know, we take for granted the right that we can get a license if we choose to, but people with a disability don't have that opportunity. So there's almost about 30% more people that could be in the transport system with AVs. And so when we talk about jobs and loss of jobs, servicing that growing sector and managing, you know, how they access and use the transport, there's huge opportunities. But also as we get older, there's a lot of benefits in keeping older people in the workforce longer, and sometimes the biggest barrier for them continuing to work is being able to get to their place of employment. So I think AVs and even the high driver assistance features can help people to drive longer and contribute to the economy longer.
Of course, as well as cars, driverless vehicles could also mobilise, even revolutionise public transport, unlocking new possibilities for mobility. What could that mean for the daily commute? We set our reporter Josh Phillips to find out.
There's a new car culture kicking off in Australia, and while we may not all be able to afford the luxury of a Tesla when it comes to electric cars, it doesn't mean that we're not going to be jumping on an electric vehicle soon, because there are already about 22 trials of autonomous vehicles or electric buses going on in Australia. But when will we see one rock up on our doorstep? I caught up with Andrew from HMI Technology, who's been running an AV shuttle trial in Sydney Olympic Park, to find out.
Hey Josh, hey, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Absolutely, and welcome to the first autonomous shuttle vehicle trial in Sydney.
Thank you.
And would you like to go for a spin?
I'd love to go for a spin.
Absolutely.
Let's do it.
Take a seat.
Cool.
This particular type of vehicle does all of its navigation by very accurate GPS and some sensors called LiDARs. You could think of it sort of like running like a tram without the need for rails. The primary reason that we're going down this path is for safety reasons. 94% of the accidents on our roads are caused by human error, And by eliminating that error, we can eliminate a lot of the deaths and injuries on our roads. And that's the primary reason that we as a company are promoting automated vehicles, and that's why worldwide they're such a big thing.
So if somebody was to walk out on the road in front of us, what would happen?
The vehicle would stop for it, or slow down, depending on how far away the pedestrian is. If they're very close, then it'll stop very suddenly. If they're a fair way away, it'll gradually slow down, wait for them to get out of the way. If they don't get out of the way, it'll stop and eventually toot a horn at them. This type of vehicle, I think, is well suited to what they call the first and last mile of travel. We see that they can be providing travel from home to the station, or from the station to office buildings and that sort of thing. And the other obvious application of these vehicles is in precincts like Sydney Olympic Park, like airport precincts, like retirement villages and these sorts of things, to provide a level of service to people that they don't have at the moment. Moving forward, where you can replace one large bus with multiple smaller buses, someone will still need to be supervising those buses in a control room or something like that. So instead of one driver driving a big bus around the back streets of a suburb, you can have one operator supervising remotely the operation of multiple smaller vehicles that will provide a richer service to the public.
Well, that was my first ride in an autonomous vehicle, and it was a truly surreal experience. And while I don't think cars or buses are going to be eliminated off our roads anytime soon, if you do see one of these around in the future, jump on and give it a go, because they're a lot of fun and they're going to take you places you may not have thought you'd go before.
Well, it seems that to change gear, we may need an alternative that's cheaper, faster, safer, and more reliable, and maybe even prettier than we have today. Then again, if your car knows where you need to go even before you do, then maybe we'll all make the leap a lot faster. That's all we have time for. Thank you so much to Rita and Ben, and thanks so much to you for watching. I'm Stephanie Bendixsen, and until next time, keep on moving.